Okay, we're here. We're doing it. I am back in Indiana, no longer in Colorado. If you guys watched the series before, you guys know I went down there to film a bunch of videos and for Jared's wedding, aka Renegade Construction Boy. So after I posted our framing Q&A video, I reached out over YouTube and asked you guys if there were any specific topics or questions that you guys have that you guys want to touch on, or you want to see some explanations on some things. So that's what I'm here doing today. We're going to try to fit all 13 comments in one video. If you are only interested in hearing a specific topic, I will have the chapters in the video so you can skip along to each question if you don't want to watch the whole thing. So first off though, if some of you guys remember from my tool belt video, it's very hard for me to keep this stuff organized and clean. And I can't film a video with it looking like a bomb went off. So that's what we're gonna have to do first real quick. And I actually am wearing the perfect socks to fit this situation. Guys, so I do this, like, I have this bucket, right, and I just put a bunch of like miscellaneous stuff in here and basically hoard it, and then whenever I need some, like whenever I need to find something, I just dump it out, which is like, because my GoPro hat I left in Colorado, so I need to make a new one. So I got this little GoPro clip on Spec Ops tool hat, but I needed to find bolts, and I couldn't find any. Well, actually, I found three little nuts that would have worked, but I couldn't find any bolts, so I just had to go buy some. Anyways, back to cleaning.
We have something of value to you. Consider this a warning. You have to claim it.
I just sucked up the bolts I just bought for the hat. Ah! Okay, so cleaning's done. I have everything that's in the back of my truck on this table, because one of the questions was what tools I use and carry around every day. So let's start off with the first question. I'll read these off my phone. The first comment's from Aaron Goddard. He said, would love to see more videos of you guys hand cutting your roofs, more detailed if you have time, or maybe a little interview with your boss and how he started off and built his business. That's a great question. I'm gonna try to get some footage of the house that we are on. It's a 812 and a 1212, all hand cut. Also, I am planning on making another learn to frame with talking about overframes and kind of figuring out valleys and stuff, which I'll be learning with you guys too. I just wanna practice again. So, you know, look out for that one. All right, and then the second part of that question was maybe a little interview with my boss, Eric. So maybe in the future, I'll have to ask him and we'll get together and make a little video on it maybe. So also be on the lookout for that one. And the next comment is from RayBands58. He asks, I love to see a video on print reading and layout. They go hand in hand and it's my biggest struggle on the job site. I feel like once you understand how to do it and do it efficiently, you can really tackle any house that comes your way. That is 100% true. And it's the one thing that messed me up when I was starting out. It took the most time to understand, but it's so simple once you get it. And print reading, I brought the print of the house that we are currently on. So Matt Bangs Wood actually has a fantastic video on print reading, which I will link in the description. Probably it would explain it a lot better than me, but I will touch on a few things with you guys real quick. And I actually have an idea, so give me 1 second. I'm gonna build a little something real quick and we'll see if we can explain layout and how simple everything actually is. Here we go. This is what I've been working on for the past couple minutes, is making this kind of scale model for you guys. And it's directly from this print. So this section right here, I basically just copied and pasted. We're gonna go over layout first real quick. So with this house, so with any house actually, we always pick a corner. It's like the master corner where you pull all of your layout from. So on this model, I did it from this corner. So I went 15 and a quarter and go there, and 15 and a quarter and go here. So all these are your stud layouts. And by the way, I didn't mark any of the exterior windows or any of the exterior doors, except for a few. But yeah, so everything's 15 and a quarter and go off of one corner. And the reason that we do that, one, it's easy. You know, you can hook that corner and you can just pull. You don't have to readjust your tape measure. And the other is a 4x8 sheet. If you put it on, right on the edge of framing, it'll split that stud both ways. So that's why we do that. So that 4x8 sheets work. And if you notice, the 4x8 sheet will split between your studs if everything is 16 on center. So let's talk about 16 on center real quick. I know I touched on it in one of my other videos. Okay, so say this is your exterior corner. Now, if I were to pull 16 and go, I would be wrong, because then my 4x8 sheet wouldn't split on that. It would be 3/4 off. So that's why we go an extra 3/4 back. Okay, so then once you're in the field, after you pulled that 15 and a quarter, if you hook that stud or that joist or whatever, then you can start going your 16 and goes. So you just mark 16. We call it and go and in back. I know it's called different in a lot of crews in a lot of areas. So, yep, 16 and go. And then if you bump it, 16 and back. So anywhere you go, and then, you know, you hold it on the center there, 16 is on center. So that's kind of the basics of layout a little bit. So now from our corner, we have all of our layouts on here. You know, this is the exterior wall, these are all interiors. And one thing I do want to show you guys, and every house should be like this, every house, is all of the studs line up perfectly. So I can put my framing square and all these studs line up. My interiors match, everything in the house should match, so that when you look through your stud bays, everything's in line. And that helps with joists. I'll explain that too. What's probably the easiest way to do it on the job site is, as long as you know that your house is parallel and square, you pull your two end walls, you get your layout on your walls right? And if you have all your interiors plated, we do this a lot when we're laying out our steel beam that's in the middle of the house. Now this wall should be straight, so technically you should be able to pull that, but what we like to do is this kind of is our string line. So think of hooking a string line there and bring it all the way over here and snapping that, and then boom, you have your line on the middle of this interior wall. So that's exactly kind of what I'm doing right there. That's my string line, pop it, and then I'm good to run that layout through. So when it comes to joists, this is a first floor. So we have a second floor deck on top of it. So, you know, you would have your rimmer, right? And usually we lay out our rimmer instead of the top of the walls when we're doing a deck. So we just, you know, someone down there marks out a rimmer 15 and a quarter and go, you send it up, nail it on. So your joist goes right there. When doing a deck, we always try to stack the studs because there's no rafter that's gonna sit on top. If it's a second floor deck, we'll stack on the exterior wall, and then that means we have to stack on the interior wall too. So I'm on my X's. Now, these joists are only spanned from here to here, but this still needs to be joisted too. So I have another joist. And now this one is just gonna sister on the other side of the line. So you don't wanna be over here. That would throw you off an inch and a half. You wanna be in back. So you put it right there. That way, that line's basically the center of these two. And that meets code. I think code in our area is 3 inches is like acceptable that you can be off of your stud. And then the second floor continues after this. So you'll have another joist that goes back on your and go layout, just like that. So this joist is gonna match that one. This is gonna be on the other side of the line. Pretty simple. So that's if you're doing like a deck, and also if you're doing a ceiling. But with ceilings, what we do, because we have rafters, so we always try to get the rafter to stack that stud. So that's our rafter, right? Actually, boom, I made a little one. So that's our rafter. You know, obviously it's gonna sit like that or something, but so that we're always gonna have to try to stack. So when you're doing your ceiling joist, you go in back of that line to leave that stud open for that rafter to stack that stud, just like that. And then with the, you know, the ceiling joist again, I can, you can just still keep alternating. Those will be in go. And a lot of the times, if this is exterior, exterior, you'll have a rafter that's gonna be inch and a half off of that layout. That makes sense. But you just pick a side and always try to get one side to stack. And then once, you know, the deck is on and we sheet it, obviously, we'll have, you literally just match all your layout, extrude it up, and you just keep going, 15 and a quarter, 15 and a quarter. So a different technique than what we use and what I was able to do over in Colorado with Jared is he lays out all of his plates just like this before they even start, you know, sticking in the studs and lifting them up. They plate everything so that they can do layout just like I did right here. And it was perfect. All my layout, I can have all my layout, all my doors, everything perfect before I start building. And I think that's like, it's so much better than how we do it. What we do is we literally just lay out as we go. Like we'll plate this wall and lay it out, and then we'll build it, stand it, plate this wall, lay it out, build it, stand it. A lot of human error can happen from that. Someone bumps something, hooks something that, or someone just reads a wrong number, someone marks something wrong. It can happen so easily. So that's why I think if you plate everything on the floor and lay it out so where everything, like you can see everything and make sure everything matches and everything works out before you start building. I think that's basically the gist of the layout. Now these interior walls, if you have joists that run here, you're never ever ever gonna have anything stacking these studs. You're never gonna have anything on this wall. That's why, if you're doing remodeling, you can take these walls out because there's no load on these walls. There's no joist on top of them, a non-load-bearing wall. Walls like these are load-bearing. Okay, enough of that. So I think that kind of explains the gist of the layout. And it's, like I said, it's pretty simple once you understand it and once you just look at the big scope of things instead of, I don't know. So yeah, I hope this little model helped. Now we're gonna move on to the blueprint. We're just gonna go over a few things real quick. So this is our first floor, main floor plan. Also, by the way, let me show you guys the rest of the house. But we got 12 12s, 8 12 is the main, dormer on the garage, a big screen porch. Actually, I don't think it's screened in, but it's another big porch that we're gonna do the decking on and everything. There's the side elevations. So when looking at your print, you'll see all these numbers over here from your exterior, right? So you have, so if you look at this from this interior wall to this exterior wall, outside of framing, you got 15.8 to the inside. I think everything, like when you're laying out interiors, all these numbers are from the inside of your walls. So we go inside to inside whenever we're like snapping our floor and stuff, which makes it pretty easy. Someone will just hold you on the inside line of, let's say, this wall, and then you mark 5.9.5, and then an extra 3.5 to get both of your wall lines, and then we can snap those out. So everything's pretty easy. It's literally like instructions. It's so simple. Like, it's just instructions. It's kind of like a map. Everything is already there for you. All you have to do is transfer it onto something really big. A few things, your doors, 6.0, 6.8. I think a lot of them say 6.8. That's the height of the door. And then the numbers before that. So that's 2.4, 6.8. So that's a 2.4 door. That's 2'4". Now with our interior doors and everything like that, they don't add it for you. So you always add, or we always add 2 inches to this. So that becomes 2.6. And then you need a header. So you have to add 1.5 inches on both sides. So that would be a 2.9. So if like Paul makes a header list, our foreman, he looks at this print and he sees all our openings and he starts making a header list so he can just start writing, you know, interiors. So we need 1.29, and then he'll go around and count how many other 2.9s we need, write that down, and then he'll do the exteriors, which that's a 6.0. We do double cripples, so that would be, and it's also, we don't have to add anything for exterior doors, so we don't have to add 2 inches. So then we'll go 6.6 would be that opening. When I first started, you know, I would always just look at the print and it would still confuse me because there's so many numbers and stuff. And it's just like, whoa, this stuff gets, I don't know. It's confusing to see, but once you get it, you get it. So actually, when we were framing this first floor, I framed and laid out these interior walls right here. And when I was doing that, I plated this wall and I started laying it out. And I always do my door and window openings first. That way you don't have any other lines in the way so that you can mark your center and you can mark your cripples and your king studs. And then you can pull all of your layout. Now, this door, I actually made a mistake. So this is why it's very important to just pay attention and don't rush yourself when you're looking at the print, because that's always how you're gonna make mistakes. Now this, I was just thinking like it was a regular door, a 6.8 door. We use 81.25 cripples. So I had our new guy Mondo cut two at 81.25 because I didn't look at this, but this says 3.0. So that is an 8-foot door and it also has these lines. I did not see that. So we framed it with 81 1/4 cripples, and we had to cut it out and raise it up all the way, because I just didn't pay attention to the detailed numbers that it gives you. So I should have recognized that, and I should have known and had him cut the right size cripples. But stuff like that happens, life goes on. So with these prints, I think this print, every 1/4 inch is a foot. So you scale it. So from that, so from this interior wall to the end of that wall is gonna be a little less than 1/4 inch. So there's your 1/4 inch. So that would be a foot. So I think we went 9 inches, I believe. So we went 9. So we just scaled that to 9 inches, and then it would be the same here, 9 inches. So a lot of the times you have to scale off the print because they don't give you those numbers. Always, always, always use your elevations when you're framing, because like, don't only just use this page, so that we can see these two windows are in line with each other. And yeah, it's always good to look at the elevation when you're framing the house, because you can see stuff that you missed or how everything's going to be. Okay, now when looking at the roof plan page, it shows you where everything's going to be. So you have your 8-12, your 12-12, arrows pointing where the rafters go, pitch changes, shows you where your valleys are. All the inside corners are going to be valleys. These are gables on the sides. This is a big gable here with a ridge in the middle, so rafters go back this way. I'm not going to go into any more detail than that. Like I said, it's pretty simple, just like reading a map. If you're good at reading instructions, you can read print. Okay, so that concludes that question and that little fun little project we just did. So the next question on the list is from Duke. He says, I know you did a tool belt video, but would like to see a video about the tools you use daily. Circular saw, nail guns, table saws, what brands you would recommend or what you would stay away from. Cheers, keep up the good work. Thanks. So, like I said earlier, I brought everything that was in my truck out so you guys can see. These are actually 2 air hoses that I need to fix. Maybe we'll fix them in this video. But we just use Senco rubber air hoses. I'll put the link in the description for them. I know a lot of guys use Flexzillas and polyurethane hoses, but we stick with the rubber. I actually like them. They're pretty durable too. I mean, I think this one's very old and we've had it for a while now. But yeah, these 2 have holes in them. So now my saws, we use the DeWalt circular saws. That's what the company has. We have 3 of them, but these are my personal saws that I keep with me at all times, because working for a home builder, I have to go do other things, and it's nice to have my own tools that I can use and always have with me. I'm not limited like, oh, I don't have the van, I don't have the tools. No, I do. All in the back of my truck. Makita 36 volt. Has 2 batteries. Very, very, very nice saw. It has a lot less power than the DeWalts that we have, but it just feels so much nicer in the hands. It's very comfortable. And yeah, I love it. Absolutely love it. No problems with it, really, like at all. And because I loved it so much, I bought the new XGT one with the 40 volt battery, just 1 battery, which is really nice. This one is a little heavier than that, but it has more power, and I really like the hook. Battery life seems the same to me, honestly, and it has the same handling as the 36 volt too, in my opinion. Now, the one thing I don't like about it is when you're doing your bevels, it's really hard to see that blade in your line. I don't know, they just have too much stuff going on inside that table. I just bought the new Metabo rear handle. Me and Jared both bought them at the same time because he saw a sale going on. It's like $200 for the saw, and you get a free battery kit, which is like pretty damn good. So next on the list, we'll go with the nail gun. Actually, we'll go with the nail guns that we use on the job site. I have a few. Now, we use these Pazlode 30 degree pro framers. We have this one. I'm pretty sure this one just double fired a lot, and that's why I kind of retired it. This one and the other gun I have, I use for parts because I have to fix the four other ones that we have a lot. But it's a solid gun. I like it. The only thing that's a pain in the butt is to change the depth. You do have to have an Allen set, and it comes with one, but they all go missing. So I have a whole bag of miscellaneous parts for the framing nailer and a bunch of air fittings and stuff. The other nail gun, my personal one that I keep, we have a DeWalt battery one in our van. That's the company's. But I recently just got this new Pazlode XP. Love it. Absolutely love it. It's so much lighter than the DeWalt. And it sucks that you do need gas and battery, but the battery is so tiny, and the gas tube, honestly, I love the smell of them. I've used this maybe 3 or 4 days on the job site. 2 of those days, I used it the whole day, and I'm still on the first gas tube that I ever bought for this thing, which is pretty cool. This is actually the nail gun that my uncle uses for remodeling houses, and it's the one that I remember always using with him. So, had to pick me up one. This is an Empire 6 foot level, just my personal one. We have 2 Stabila plate levels that we use on the job site. We also have some 4 footers. Brands doesn't really matter. I think our 4 footer is a DeWalt, and we have like 2 Stabila 2 footers and then the 2 plate levels. I think it just depends, honestly. I really like any of them. I have this crappy Harbor Freight 4 foot level that does its job, you know? So no real big recommendation there. Huh? Now the next thing I keep is this big bag. It has my chargers. And the one other thing that it does have in it is a bunch of miscellaneous stuff. So a lot of nails. I never have to worry about having nails when I'm out doing something. I have all of these. Got some bolts. There's its nuts, washers down here, bits. There's some shims in here. And I cannot stress enough how much I've used this thing when I'm out doing something random. Next, we have my battery bag. I have this Makita drill set. The only reason I bought that Makita drill set is so I can have more batteries for my 36 volt saw. So I think I have like around 8 batteries in there. Next we have just a bag. I think I carry the saws in here. I have a Makita Sawzall. Again, I bought it just so I can have the battery for my saw. And then next, I carry my tool belt in my truck, obviously. Now this, you guys haven't seen before unless you saw it on Instagram. This is my newest tool belt. This is an Occidental leather and an Agribus leather combo, which is pretty sick. I got this belt in this back pouch from one of my buddies, Ethan, in Colorado, which he was kind enough to let me buy it from him. So I went out and bought 2 full leather ones instead of the canvas ones, because I have another Occidental set, but it's half leather, half canvas. So this is really nice to actually have a leather, and they're doing really nice. And another thing I did with it is I bought an extra Diamondback tool belt hammer holster, and I bolted it on. Jared did this, and so did Patrick on his crew, which that's the first time I saw it. So obviously I had to do it. But yeah, nothing more to say about these. I can do a more in-depth video if you guys want, but it's basically the same exact tools that were in my first tool belt video, just in a different tool belt. So, I did get new suspenders too. These are really stretchy and I really like them. And I also carry a framing square. This is just a Johnson framing square with me because sometimes I do have to cut stair stringers and everything. And the last thing that I carry is this rigid job box. Carry a little ratchet set with me. Always needs it. But this is kind of where I throw just a bunch of miscellaneous stuff. I have Tyvek tape. I have some stretch zip tape. I have a lot of my hammers. This one just broke. More hammers. My other suspenders I have. I got bolts. I got roofing nails. I got extra squares. I got a big 12 in there. I carry my 40 foot Fat Max in there. That comes in handy sometimes. I have a caulk gun in there, ratchet straps, duct tape, basically anything that I would need. So that's basically the gist of what I carry in the back of my truck. Usually this is enough for most of the things that I have to do when I'm on my own. Table saws. My boss Eric, he has a DeWalt table saw that we use on a job site sometimes, and I love it. It's a great little table saw. That's what I would recommend. I don't have one personally. The one I have is a crappy Harbor Freight one that I've had since I was like 15. So maybe one day I'll splurge out and get like a big saw stop if I get a big enough shop. Going on to the next question is from Jaden Swayford. What are all the tools you carry and use on a daily basis? So I'll just combine that question with the previous question. The next question is, Humility is Key. He says, do a video why all you weirdos wear van shoes and not boots. LOL, JK, all love. But for real, that's weird where I'm at. So I've always worn Vans like back in high school and everything in middle school. So I'm very comfortable in them. That's part of the reason why I wear them. I do have work boots that I do wear. These are Red Wing 877s that I've had for maybe around 2 years now. Very good boot. Takes a while to wear in, but they're very nice. I do still wear these. If it's raining, if it's wet, I know there's gonna be mud. I'll always have these in the truck and I'll put these on instead of my Vans. A lot of the times, especially in like this heat, they get very uncomfortable. Your feet get hot. So that's why I wear my Vans. Nice flat sole, so it's really nice to walk on top plates and everything. And they also have very good traction for roof sheeting. Like, we don't have to wear a steel toe. This isn't a steel toe. We don't have to wear any of those. But I'm sure if you're union and or on a commercial site, you have to. Like, it's mandated, but. All right, so the next question is from Riley R. He says, can you show me your skill saw tattoo? Interested in getting one like it. So the skill saw tattoo, Jared Kaufman again. He's the one that gave me it at JLC Live. We'll see if we can get a nice view of it. I have A squared plus B squared equals C squared on it. I think Jared, he has Stay True, which is the skill saw kind of thing. But yeah, it's just a worm drive skill saw with a cool little bone hand on it. And the fun thing is about it is Jared has it. A lot of Jared's friends have it. Landon, Ethan, I think Patty has it. Not too sure. But yeah, so we're all part of this cool little skill saw crew. The next question is from, it's actually not a question, it's from Matt Bangs Wood, which was like, crazy to see. I was like, holy crap. He just commented, casually steals all the content ideas here. Be my guest. That was awesome to see. That made my night. So the next question is from Drew Keith. He asks, are you union? If you're not, why not? If you are, why are you? If you could do it all again, which would you choose? I am not union. I've never been in the union. I never tried to get into the union. I figured out it was really hard to get into. I have a buddy he's an electrician and he's in the union, and it took him so long to get into the union. And it was just, I don't know. I'm sure, you know, because you get a pension, you get all these benefits, which is a plus, but I've heard that you get laid off a lot and your job environment's always changing. You might not work with the same crew every day, and that's not something that I really kind of wanted. I just work for a home builder, not union or anything. And if you could do it all again, which would you choose? I would choose non-union, personally. I don't do it for the money or the pension or the crazy benefits. I just do it because I like doing it. So whatever makes me comfortable, that's what I'm going to do. So next question is from Bestese. We'll go with that. He says, I want to go into carpentry school, but I wonder if I get a job as a carpenter, is it obligatory for me to do roofing? I'm scared of heights and I truly don't want to do roofing. So, and actually, Matt Bangs Wood had a great response on his comment, which he says, I could work for the next 30 years and never step foot on a top plate or a roof. Every project has a cut guy. 9 times out of 10, the cut guy knows more than the person putting the stuff together. Be smart with numbers, pay attention, be safe, and think ahead. They say the more you know, the less you do, and it's true. If you are uncomfortable, we will never have you do something that you are not comfortable doing. Like, you can always just stay on the ground, you can cut, and yeah, you can be the brains. You know, you don't have to be the one on the top plates and sheeting the roof if you don't want to. There's so many different jobs in carpentry that you can do that doesn't involve a big risk of heights or falling. All right, so that kind of completes all the questions that I ended up getting. And if you guys do want me to do a part two, I would be more than happy to. Just leave your questions and the specific topics that you want covered in the comment section, and I'll try to get another part two up. All this is about helping people that are unsure of things, because I know when I was starting out, it was just like, I had all these questions about how things were done, and it was just hard to find videos on YouTube from, like, I don't know, a framer my age explaining these sort of things, because I'm still only not even 3 years in. So I'm still learning a lot. So that's kind of, I'm just passing on my experience with you guys. All right, so the last thing I'm gonna do in this video is I'm gonna put that GoPro clip on that hat just for fun, just so you guys can see it. All right, well, when I was vacuuming and I vacuumed up the bolts, I lost two of the nuts. So we're only gonna use two on this, which is gonna just work just fine. I don't think you need four. Okay. So all I'm gonna do, this little drill bit. Well, that's great. Just gonna drill. Two holes right there. And then we're gonna find a drill bit the same diameter as this bolt. Perfect. I'm only gonna drill enough to where that countersinks in. So I'm not gonna try to go through all of the plastic. Hopefully it works. I remember the last time I had one that kinda didn't work too well, but. Boom. That's perfectly recessed in there. Nice and flat so that clip can slide through. All right, and so once those holes are drilled, I went tight to the back of the bill, center it, and then you can drill right through. Right through the hat. And then I believe I need an Allen wrench. There she goes, bolted on. Okay guys, so that concludes this little video. I hope it was helpful and useful. Like I said, if you want to see more, let me know. I'm going to be starting another Learn to Frame, like I said before earlier, soon, and then some woodworking projects too that I want to tackle.